Ya Rasulallah, Ya Habiballah, Ya Rasulallah, Ya Rasulallah, Ya Habiballah, Ya Habiballah, Salla alayka Ya Rasulallah, Rasulallah, Sallim alayka Ya Habiballah.
جو آ جائے نظر یا رسول اللہ یا رسول اللہ خواب میں تو جو آ جائے نظر تو پھر آنکھیں نہ کھلیں خواب میں تو جو آ جائے نظر تو پھر آنکھیں نہ کھلیں ہم نے مدت سے یہ منصوبہ بنا رکھا ہے ہم نے مدت سے یہ منصوبہ بنا رکھا ہے اور قرب مل جائے جو اس ذات گرامی کا ندیم قرب مل جائے جو اس ذات گرامی کا ندیم تو یوں سمجھ اسی قرب میں قرب خدا رکھا ہے اسی قرب میں قرب خدا رکھا ہے اور محمد ایسے نہیں صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم محمد رونق بزم جہاں بھی ہیں جہاں بھی ہیں وہ زینت سب مکانوں کی مکینے لا مکان بھی ہے اور میرے دل میں مدینہ ہے میرا دل ہے مدینے میں میرے دل میں مدینہ ہے میرا دل ہے مدینے میں میں یہ سمجھا میرے آقا وہاں بھی ہے یہاں اور شاعر کہتا ہے کہ محمد کے صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم آپ کے نظر یہ شعر کر رہا محمد کے یہ دیوانے بڑے ہوشیار ہوتے ہیں ڈیلے پڑ گئے ہیں بابا زیب کر کیا سبحان اللہ ایسے نہیں مزہ نہیں آئے بابا زیب کر حضور کا جشن ہے مسکرا کے بیٹھے مسکرا کے بیٹھنا بھی ثواب بابا زیب کر سبحان اللہ محمد کے یہ دیوانے بڑے ہوشیار ہوتے ہیں بظاہر میں یہ دیوانے مگر ہوشیار ہوتے ہیں بظاہر میں یہ دیوانے مگر ہوشیار ہوتے ہیں انہی کے ماننے والوں نے مجھ کو راز بدلایا انہی کے ماننے والوں نے مجھ کو راز بدلایا مہکتی ہے وہی محفل کہ جس میں سرکار ہوتے ہیں Indeed the great blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his beloved Rasul سید الاولین والآخرین سیدنا حبیب مصطفیٰ احمد مجتبیٰ صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم and why it was say سید الاولین والآخرین because he was the one who was created first but sent last created first but sent last and how was he created first Allah سبحانہ وتعالی mentioned in حدیث قدسی in regards to his creation he says there was a time when nothing existed. No one knew who I was. No one was aware of me. No one was aware of my oneness. No one would do my ibadah. I had not created anyone for my ibadah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says it was me, myself, and I was alone. And he says that what happened on Allah? He says, and then I fell in love. Say subhanAllah. The world, my dear brothers, just understand what did the world begin from? How did this universe come into being? This universe did not come into, and how did Islam spread? My dear brothers, this hadith shows us, and beloved sisters, this hadith shows us that Islam and deen did not spread through any other means. Through any other means apart from love. Apart from muhabba. Now the question is, what muhabba and which muhabba? Allah says, then I fell in love. Oh Allah, what was that love? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I fell in love for me to now be recognized. For me to now be recognized. For people to now come and worship me. For people to understand me. For people to accept me. For people to do ibadah before me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, when I fell in love, what did I do? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, when I fell in love, I was because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I myself am nur. I myself am light. So because I fell in love and I wanted my recognition to take place. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Hadith-i Qudsi, that I fell in love. And when I fell in love from my nur, I created the same. we were born into this world through various other means. Some people accept the Big Bang Theory. Some people think that we just appeared into this world. Some people say we were transferred into this world. Many reasons, many opinions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What do you say? He mentions in Hadith al-Qudsi, he says, oh, Rasulullah, go and announce. Tell the people that, oh, Rasulullah, he says, go and announce the people again in Hadith al-Qudsi. He says that, oh, Rasulullah, if I had not created you, if I had not created you, Ya Rasulullah, he says, then I would not have created the skies. And then he says, oh, Rasulullah, make a second announcement. Make a second announcement. Oh Allah, what is it? Subhanallah. Look at Hadith al-Qudsi. Learn a lesson from today. What is Hadith al-Qudsi? Today we are very, very eminent on doing lectures, very eminent on going to do tabligh, but we do not learn our basics. Hadith, remember, whenever Allah speaks in two ways or two forms, or His words come into two forms. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks, either the form, either His kalam falls in to Al-Quran, the kalam of Allah, and the second form of Allah's words, Allah's kalam, is Hadith al-Qudsi. And oh Allah, how does Hadith al-Qudsi work? Because we understand the kalam of Allah came through Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi salam and was revealed to Rasulullah. How does it mean? He says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, that is my words, but I use the tongue of Rasulullah. My words, but I use the tongue of Rasulullah. He says, oh Rasulullah, announce, if I had not created you, I would not have created the universe. And he says, oh Rasulullah, if I had not created you, then I would not have revealed my oneness. So now the question comes into being. This was at the beginning when the Prophet was created, not when he was sent. No, this is, I'm talking about the creation of Rasulullah. When the Prophet was created, at the time of his creation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says it was his nur that first came into existence. Through his nur, everything else came into existence. And today, if we recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we recognize the skies, we recognize the earth, anything and everything else, we recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it clear in this hadith al-Qudsi that don't turn to any way, any other means of this recognition. If today you recognize me, you recognize the plants, you recognize the skies, you recognize paradise, everything you recognize, then you recognize it only because of the nur of Rasulullah. It was due to the nur of Rasulullah I created this universe. Now the question comes, oh Allah, what did you do then? He says, once I created Rasulullah, the nur of Rasulullah, then I began to send the prophets. What did I do then? Say it. I began to send the prophets. One after the other, I began to send the prophets. And he says, from the first of the prophets, I sent Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam. Say subhanAllah. Everything, every prophet that came accepted Rasulullah. Every prophet that came had iman in Rasulullah. Every prophet that came believed in Rasulullah. Every prophet that came accepted Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Every prophet that came accepted the nur of Rasulullah. Every prophet that came accepted the prophethood of Rasulullah. Now you will ask why. Let's ask the first prophet, Adam alayhi salam. When Sayyidina Adam was born, after the creation of Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam, you all know how the birth took place. But after the creation, when Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decided to extend humanity, when Allah decided to extend humanity, so He created Sayyidina Habba from Adam alayhi salam. Now what takes place when one gets married? In nikah, for nikah there is one obligation for nikah. There is one sharai, one obligation that must take place during nikah, in order for the nikah to take place. And what is that sharai? What is that? For those who have had their nikah, you will know this already. And for those who haven't, may Allah give you nikah very soon as well, inshallah. For the sake of the mawlid of Rasulullah. The other sharai is haqq al-mahar, which in English we call dowry. We refer to as? Say it, we refer to as dowry. Haqq al-mahar, which is a certain amount that a man must give to his missus at the time of wedding. According to Islam and according to the Sharia of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam, Sayyidina Habba was created from Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam. Now it was the time for nikah. Nikah takes place. Allah said, Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam is now looking towards the skies. that, oh Allah, one of the shara'it, one of the sharia, one of the laws is in order for me to get married in Sayyida Hawa, I must give haqq al-mahr, but I have nothing for to give. I have nothing physically on me to give. What do I give? I need your concentration on me. I know many people will come, and very soon you will see His Eminence will arrive and inshallah ta'ala light this nabi, but until then, concentrate. He's saying the other day started looking towards the sky, that, oh Allah, now I'm to get married with Sayyida Hawa, what am I to give? I have nothing physical, no money, nothing else to give. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is now asking, seeking from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oh Allah, how am I to get married in nikah? How am I to enter the nikah of Sayyida Hawa when I have nothing physically to give? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, oh Adam alayhi salam, do not worry. Yes, many people give rings, people give cars, people give various other things at the time of haqq al-mahr, but oh Adam, you have nothing to give, then give your wife the best of things. Oh Allah, what is the best of things that I can give? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is the nikah of Sayyidina Adam and saying. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, then 20 times, or according to some narration, 70 times, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, send darood upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You will send 20 times darood upon Rasulullah, your nikah will be accepted by Allah. That was the haqq al-mahr given by Adam alayhi salam. 20 times of darood upon Rasulullah. And today, people say that even the Prophet was not aware of his prophethood. وَلِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ Sayyidina Adam, even at his time, at his creation, at his nikah, on his wedding ceremony, at his nikah, he is sending darood upon Rasulullah. Now the question comes, oh Adam, let's ask Sayyidina Adam. Oh Adam alayhi salam, how did you recognize Rasulullah? How did you say this? How did you recognize Rasulullah? Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam says, let me tell you my event. Again, this is mentioned in Sahih Hadith. He says, I was in paradise. And I'm not going to go into the long, the depth of the story, but once I was in paradise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, everything in paradise is open for you. Do not eat from this one tree and and take this apple from this tree. You are all aware of that story. Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam, he said, an act of nisyan, which means forgetfulness. Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam, forgetting that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, do not eat from this tree. Do not take from this, forgetting this. And why did he forget? Even that forgetfulness was in the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was in love with Allah so much, extremely, that everything that was, that even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, avoid this tree, because he was lost in the love of Allah. He was on the stage of ecstasy with the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He even forgot that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, do not eat from this tree. Today people use that against the Prophet. Well, yeah, no, this was the love of Adam for me. This was his love for Allah. Anyway, he ate from the tree, and then, as you know, he was sent down from paradise. Once he was sent down from paradise, many, many years passed. Sayyidina Adam al-Islam was doing tawbah. Oh Allah, forgive me. Used many wasilas, used many means, means of intercession. Oh Allah, forgive me. Oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, forgive me. Oh Allah, forgive my error. Oh Allah, my error was done in forgetfulness, in nisyan. Forgive me. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was awaiting for the right wasila to be given in order for Adam to be forgiven. One day, Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam, he raises his hands and he says, oh Allah, many years I've asked for forgiveness, but today I raise my hands and oh Allah, I ask you and I ask you for forgiveness, but oh Allah, I do not present anything else before you. I do not present my amal before you. I do not present my prophethood before you. I do not present anything else before you. Oh Allah, today I ask you for forgiveness and I present before you the name of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala there and then, he says the glad tidings that, oh Adam, you have been forgiven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But oh Adam, answer one question. How did you recognize Rasulullah when we have not yet sent Rasulullah? How did you recognize him when he has not been sent into this world? He has not yet been born into this world. Announce, let the people know, inform us. How did you recognize Rasulullah? Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam says, he says, oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when I was in paradise, and he says, I take an oath in the name of Allah. He says, I was in paradise, and upon my visit in paradise, upon my stay in paradise, he says, every time I looked at the skies, everywhere around the skies, either I saw, it was written, La ilaha illallah, and beside it, next to it, it was written, Muhammad Rasulullah. He says, I saw the trees, on the trees was written, La ilaha illallah, beside it, next to it, Muhammad Rasulullah. He says, I saw myself, how beloved must this Muhammad be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How must Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala love Rasulullah? How much must he be pleased with Rasulullah? How much honor must he have for Rasulullah? How much love must he have for Rasulullah? That the whole of paradise is decorated with the name of Rasulullah. He says, when I saw this, I said, I will use this wasila. Saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, oh Allah, this wasila that you have used, today you have used the name of Sayyidina Rasulullah. You have used the name of my Habibullah. Therefore, you have been forgiven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why, what was the Prophet's status? The Prophet's status was he was Habibullah. What was he? Say it now with great love and great joy. He was?
Habibullah.
One more time, he was?
Habibullah.
Once again, he was?
Habibullah.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam alayhi salam. He made him Safiullah. He created Nuh alayhi salam. He made him Najihullah. He created Ismail alayhi salam. He made him Zabihullah. He created Ibrahim alayhi salam. He made him Khalilullah. He created Isa alayhi salam. He made him Ruhullah. He created Musa alayhi salam. He made him Kalimullah. Then when it came to Rasulullah, he says, oh Rasulullah, you are very different. Subhanallah. You are very different. Today people say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala distributed various miracles to the Prophet. And he gave miracles to the Prophet as well. But certain miracles other prophets had, the Prophet did not have. Let me clarify this today. This is not the case. Every miracle that every prophet was given to Rasulullah. Was gifted to Rasulullah. There was not any miracle that any previous prophet had and the Prophet did not have. Everything was gifted to Rasulullah. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, oh Rasulullah, when it came to your being, and that's why a great Nakhan and Nasheed artist of the time of Rasulullah, Sayyidina Hassan bin Sabit, he says, wa ahsanu min kalam tarakat du'ayni. In regard, he sings the maulid of Rasulullah in front of Rasulullah. He sings the maulid of Rasulullah in front of Rasulullah. And what is the maulid of Rasulullah? Over here, imagine. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, he says, oh Rasulullah, your status is so different that when I came to create you, there was various ways in which I could have created you. But oh Rasulullah, your creation is so different. It's so immense, it's so great. It's the best. How? Oh Rasulullah, when I created you, I made you Safiullah. I made you Khalilullah. I made you Zabihullah. I made you Ruhullah. I made you Kalimatullah. And the various 99 names of Rasulullah. He says, I gave you many shans, many statuses. But oh Rasulullah, more than all, yes, you are Safiullah as well, Zabihullah as well, Najihullah as well, Ruhullah as well, Kalimatullah as well, Kalimullah as well. But more than all, oh Rasulullah, you are Habibullah, the most beloved of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We made you Habibullah. What was the Prophet he was?
Habibullah.
And that's why, what is the meaning of Habibullah? That's why the Quran says, وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرًا. Oh Rasulullah, now your zikr will be raised so much that your zikr has been raised, your status has been raised for you, Ya Rasulullah. For your happiness. And in Hadith, you could see again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, now, you have seen from my, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you have seen now my rule and my discipline is. This is Allah's rule and Allah's discipline. He says, my rule and my discipline is that now wherever you will find my name, Allah says, wherever you will find my name, Allah says, now you will always find the Prophet's name alongside my name. This is Hadith, it could say, إِلَّا الْأُزْكَى حَتَّى تُزْكَى. Says, now my rule is, that wherever you will find my name, with it, O Rasulullah, this is your status. With it, O Rasulullah, you will find your name. Now let's put this in practice. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, look at the kalima. Imagine, look at the kalima. He says, you can all your life say, La ilaha illallah. Throughout your life, you can say, La ilaha illallah. Until and unless you do not say, Muhammadur Rasulullah, your kalima is not accepted. All your life, you can call the azan and say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. He says, even in azan, the call to prayer, until and unless you do not say, Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, Your azan will not be accepted. Your ikamah will not be accepted. Up to the extent he says you will see everywhere, wherever you find your name, you will find my name. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says up to the extent, if you look at your salah, your salah, your prayer, your five time daily prayers, which is tawheed khalis, only and absolutely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says even in salah, you will find my name, but even in prayer, which is only for me, even in prayer, you will find your name as well, guys. Now the question is how? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, remember, the rules of Sharia are that salah is only for Allah. It's known as tawheed-e khalis. Tawheed-e? Only and absolutely for? Allah, say it, only and absolutely for?
Allah.
No one else. Salah can not be performed to no one else. Up to the extent that if you are in salah, if you are in salah, when you are in salah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, in salah, if anyone comes up to you and says to you, assalamu alaykum, and you are in salah, you are not allowed to reply by saying, wa alaykum assalam. The moment you are in your salah and you say, wa alaykum assalam, your salah has become null and void. You would have to repeat your salah. Even if your teacher comes to you and says, wa alaykum assalam, salah becomes, and you reply to his salah, null and void. Even if your mother comes to you, says, salamu alaykum, you are in salah, wa alaykum assalam, your salah becomes null and void. Even if your shaykh comes up to you and he says, salamu alaykum, and you reply, wa alaykum assalam, your salah becomes null and void. You must repeat that salah. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, why? The question is why? Allah says, because in salah, you should not have the intention, or you should not have anyone else's thought in your mind. Because salah is only and absolutely for? I don't want you to say the name of Allah like this. Very soon, you will see His Eminence will arrive and we would like to welcome His Eminence, Sayyidi Shaykh Hisham Kabbani, Zalallahu Sharfu, with the great name of Allah. So let's practice that. Everyone say again the name of Allah.
Allah.
Like this with love.
Allah.
With muhabba.
Allah.
Happiness.
Allah.
With a smiling face.
Allah.
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 Again Allah.
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 Subhanallah. So tawheed, salah is only for Allah. And if anyone else's thought or your salah is your thoughts or your intention is diverted anywhere else during salah, you will have to repeat that salah. Now let's take the practical of salah. The practical of salah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says when you start by salah, you say Allahu Akbar. And when you raise your hands, raising your hands is a sign of submission. What is it? A sign of? If somebody puts a gun in front of you, who's ready to come and steal from you, when he puts something in front of you, what do? You raise? I you submit to him. So raising your hands is a sign of, say it, sign of
submission.
So we start our salah by submitting ourselves to Allah. We say Allahu Akbar, raising our hands, submitting ourselves to Allah. Then how does the salah begin? It begins with tilawah. We start by saying Allahu Akbar. We do the salah. We do the hamd of Allah. We then go on to bowing down. We say Subhan Rabbi al-Azim. We praise Allah. Then we put from forward place our head on the foreground. Then we say Subhan Rabbi al-A'la. We say He is the most highest. He is the most a'la. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The more the salah is going towards its conclusion, the more the salah is going towards its ending, everything until the ending of salah, we mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the zikr of Allah, the name of Allah, the tasbih of Allah, the praise of Allah. Everything remains according to the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But as salah is coming towards its end, and salah is coming towards its peak, and salah is coming towards its acceptance, now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, before concluding your salah, before your salah is now about to be accepted, before your salah is now about to be honored, now for the acceptance of your salah, say, As-salamu alayka, ayyuhan nabiyyu, I now send salah upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. of Allah. We were told that the law of Sharia tells us, Islamic law tells us, that if we say salam to anyone else, if we say salam or think of anyone else during salah, as it's only for you, our salah will be broken, our salah will be null and void. We would have to repeat our salah. But now in salah itself, you are saying when the salah has reached its most highest, its most peak, it's coming towards its conclusion, it's coming towards its ending. And remember, the conclusion is always the greatest of everything. The ending is always shows you always the status of everything. Like today's gathering, it's amazing, it's amazing, it's full of light. Why? Because its conclusion is full of light. Why is its conclusion full of light? It's because in this mahfil, we will receive the ziyarah of the Mu'i Mubarak, the hair of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Therefore, you see, everything is based upon its conclusion. The conclusion is the ending of anything is always immaculate. Over here, when salah is coming towards its conclusion, of the whole rule of salah was, do not think of anyone, do not say salam to anyone. Moment you say salam, your salah is broken, becomes null and void. But here Allah Himself is saying, now before you end salah, send salam upon Rasulullah. Say assalamu alayka ayyuhan nabiyyu, and then your salam will be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Oh Allah, we ask you, a moment before we were told, no salam to anyone. Here you are telling us yourself, now send salam upon Rasulullah. How come the rules have changed? How come the regulations have changed? He says, yes, yes, I said, you do not send salam to anyone else. Sending salam to anyone will break your salah. But how dare you say my prophet is anyone? How dare you say my prophet is anyone? I said you may send salam. If you send salam to anyone, your salah will be accepted. But my prophet is not anyone. No, my prophet is the one whose nur was great from my nur, who was great from my nur, who was sent this to this world from my nur. That's why the prophet says, na khuda hai, na khuda se juda hai. Allah hi ko maloom hai, kya jaani hai, kya hai. That he's not Allah, but that's because he's not Allah. But this is our iman, that yes, he is not Allah. We do not declare him as Allah, but he's not separate from Allah as well. If you say he's Allah, then again you are out of the fold of Islam. But if you say he's separate from Allah, our aqidah is, then again you are out of the fold of Islam as well.
Nara takbir!
I've just been informed that His Eminence, Sayyidi Shaykh Hisham Kabbani, Zadullah Sharfu, is arriving very, very shortly, and we're requesting that as the space is now becoming limited, all of the youngsters can come and sit at the front on this empty carpet, the empty space here. We're requesting the youngsters to do this, inshallah. Many, many benefits of this. You might think, oh, I'm sitting on the floor. No, the more you're sitting over here, you're sitting more close to the shayukh that are about to arrive. Inshallah, ta'ala, which will be full of blessings. By the time you're doing this, Allah, 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 Allah. So we find that even in salah, even our salah, which is Tawheed al-Khalis, the rule of salah is that to complete, for your salah to be accepted, for your salah to be completed, you send salam upon Rasulullah. Now, very briefly, now let's come towards the birth of Rasulullah. Rabi'ul Nur has come. The month of Rabi'ul Nur has come. The month of the birth of Rasulullah has come. So let's discuss about the birth of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Subhanallah. What we are all gathered here for? And what was the birth of Rasulullah? I would like you, and I would like this discussion to be taken place from the house of Sayyida Amina. Say subhanallah. From the house of Sayyida Amina. What does Sayyida Amina say? Sayyida Amina, my dear brothers, again, is mentioned in hadith. When a mother gives birth to a child, she goes through various pains. Various pains. And those of you would have had who have your mothers, and those of your husbands who have your wives, you would have seen this. 9 months full of pain, full of various other things, full of problems, full of tension, full of various pains. Oh Sayyidah Amna, you tell us a bit about yourself. Sayyidah Amna says that the Prophet had entered into my womb. He was in my womb for 9 months. And before the announcement of Sayyidina Jibreel, I even Sayyidina Jibreel, the angel of light, angel Gabriel came down and gave me the glad tidings that the Prophet is in my womb. She said, before that time, I was unaware that the Prophet was in my womb. What she was saying is not that I was not going to be informed later. No, she says that all of that pain that women face during pregnancy, all of those difficulties that women face during their pregnancy, that 9 months of suffering, she says, because in my womb was Sayyidina Rasulullah. She says, forget 9 months, I did not even have 1 month of suffering. In fact, every day of the 9 months was blessing for me, so much blessing, that so much blessing, so much raham, so much mercy. 9 months the Prophet remained in the womb, remained in my womb, and I had no idea, no pain, no agony, no grief was felt in my womb. This was all due to the blessing of the birth of Rasulullah. Then she says that now when Sayyidina Jibreel comes, he gives me the glad tidings. Then he says that before the birth of Rasulullah, Sayyidina Asma, radiallahu ta'ala, Sayyidina Asma says, I was in the house of Rasulullah. He says, being in the house of Rasulullah, we are now coming close to the birth of Rasulullah, or the moments of the birth of Rasulullah. She says, he says, I was also in the house of Rasulullah. And as I was in the house, we were awaiting the birth, awaiting the arrival of Rasulullah. Sayyidina Asma says that during that time, I looked at the house of Rasulullah, at the house of Sayyidina Amina, and at the same time, I looked at the skies. He says, do you know what I saw in the skies? He said, on the skies I saw that once I was looking on the ground, Sayyidina Asma is reporting this, hadith on Sahih. He says, I looked on the ground, then I looked on the skies, and I saw that the stars were rotating in the skies. The stars were in the combination of the skies. The stars were in movement of the skies. He saw, I said, so I saw so much movement. I saw so much movement on the stars in the skies, as if I thought that they are coming so close. The stars were coming closer and closer and closer to the house of Sayyidina Amina. He says, I saw the stars were coming so close. For a moment I thought maybe the stars will come and fall down in the house of Sayyidina Rasulullah. He said, so much movement I saw in the stars. Today people say to us, one thing that comes to my mind from the movement of the stars. People say to us, when we listen to Naat, why do we do raqs? Why do we do raqs? Why do we move around? When we enjoy something, why do we move around? We say, forget us, forget the mu'min, forget the believers moving around. When it came time for the birth of Rasulullah, forget mu'minin, forget believers, forget humans, the stars were moving around as Rasulullah. He says, we saw the movement of the stars. Then he says, we saw that two maids, how many? Two maids came down from paradise. This was now the time of the birth of Rasulullah. Subhanallah. Two maids from paradise come down to the house of Sayyidina Amina. And they say that they looked from a very similar tribe, as they were very tall. They looked from a very similar tribe, as they were very tall, but they came down. And as they came down from paradise, they approached Sayyidina Amina. Sayyidina Amina says they approached him. And they said, here, take this drink. This drink that has been prepared for you, and it's come from paradise. Take this drink, and then once you will complete this drink, then inshallah you will see the arrival of Rasulullah. She says, I looked at that drink that the maids had brought from where? Subhanallah. From where? Paradise. He says, the maids had brought from paradise. Now you will be thinking, the maids from paradise. Yes, the maids from paradise. On the arrival of Rasulullah, he says, I saw they came down, and as they came down with the drink, she says, I looked at that drink. She goes, the moment I drank from that drink, from that fluid of paradise, she saw, said, the moment I tasted that fluid, as the moment I tasted that fluid, I saw that that fluid that I tasted, that water, that drink that I tasted from paradise, she said, when I looked at it, it was whiter than milk. She says, when I tasted it, it was cooler than ice. And she says, it was sweeter than honey. She says, I drank that milk, that drink, which was whiter than milk, cooler than ice, sweeter than honey. She says, the moment I drank from that milk, that I drank from that liquid of paradise, the moment I complete, then in this world, in this universe, arrived the greatest of mankind, Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And how did everyone know about the arrival of Rasulullah? He says, the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made everyone aware and alert of the arrival of Rasulullah. Today people ask us the questions that we have flags in this venue. We have various decorations. Why do we have decorations? Where is this permissible from? Again, look at the hadith in Qudsi, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made an announcement, and he said that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that, oh, Angel Jibreel, go and raise one flag on the east side of the universe, and one flag on the west side of the universe, and one flag on top of the roof of the Holy Kaaba. Saying that Jibreel is saying, oh Allah, what is the reason for these flags to be raised? What is the reason for these flags to be raised? What is the reason for this decoration to take place? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I have not finished here. Go to paradise and raise 70,000 trees full of greenery. Fresh trees in paradise. The trees are being decorated. The stars are being decorated. Everything is being decorated. Allah himself is raising three flags. One in the east, one in the west, one on top of the roof of the Kaaba. The question is, why is all of this decoration taking place? Why is all of this arrangements taking place? All of this preparation taking place? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, oh Jibreel, tell the universe, tell the angels, tell everyone and everything to come in movement, because all these decorations, all this decoration, all this preparation is only and only for the arrival of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is me showing my love. This is me celebrating the Maulid of Rasulullah. And then as the Prophet is born, subhanAllah, Sayyidina Anas says, I drank that milk, and once I completed drinking that liquid that was given to me, arrived in this dunya, arrived in this universe, arrived on this earth, the greatest of mankind, Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, arrived Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he says, upon his arrival, again we ask Sayyidina Amina, what was the situation? What did you see? What did you realize? What did you notice? What feelings did you have? Sayyidina Amina says, the mother of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she reports, today people question the nur of Rasulullah. People question the light of Rasulullah. We don't turn to any book. We don't turn anywhere else. We turn to the mother of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We turn to Sayyidina Amina. We ask us, you tell us about the nur of Rasulullah. Sayyidina Amina says, she says, the moment I gave birth to Rasulullah, the moment the Prophet, he came into this universe, the moment the Prophet arrived into this world, she said, I swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there was so much nur, so much light that came out from my womb. The moment the Prophet was born and he arrived in this world, there was so much nur, so much light, that me sitting in Mecca, giving birth to Rasulullah in Mecca, I was in Mecca, and 300 miles away I could see the streets of Syria through the nur of Rasulullah. This was the status of the nur of Rasulullah. And Sayyidina Amina says at that time, and this is the message I'm ending with, and within the next few minutes, Sayyidi Shaykh Hisham Kabbani will be in front of our eyes, inshaAllah ta'ala. I'm ending with this message, and this message for you, that we see the O Rasulullah, the moment he arrives in this universe, and this is for all of you, and for all of us to take home with us today. The message that we understand, that when the Prophet was born, the first thing that the Prophet does, what is the first thing that Prophet does? As you are aware, we all have children as well. When we have children, what do our children do? When they're born, they either cry, or either they're in need of milk, or they need of some substance to keep themselves going, to keep themselves relieved. Sayyidina Amina says, no, the moment the Prophet is born, the moment he is born, Sayyidina Amina says, what I saw, that the moment the Prophet is born, she says, I see that the first thing that the Prophet does, he does sajda before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He does sajda before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, the moment he does sajda, we see on the back of Rasulullah, we look at the back of Rasulullah, and on the back of Rasulullah, we see the stamp of Nabuwa on the back of Rasulullah. He says, and then after seeing the back of the stamp of Nabuwa on the back of Rasulullah, the family members of Rasulullah, they say, we place our ears close by to Rasulullah to see what is this child saying. This child that has been born into the world, what is he saying? He says, the moment we place our ears beside Rasulullah to see what are the words of Rasulullah, we see and we are made to hear the first words of Rasulullah, Ya Rabbi Habli Ummati, O Allah, have mercy upon my Ummah, Ya Allah. This was the first word by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And oh Ummah, today you are turning away from Rasulullah. Today we are making someone else our ideal. Today we are not ready to stand for the status of Rasulullah. We are not ready to stand for the protection of the honor of Rasulullah. My dear brothers, this is not something that when we do it, it's not something that the Prophet will benefit from. No! Every time we will spend our life in the Sunnah, following the Seerah of Rasulullah, then my dear brothers, this is an act that we will benefit from. This is an act that we will receive life from. My message to you today, and from this gathering, from this mapping, is turn your ideals towards Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Make him your ideal. Today when you come to dress, then dress right Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When you come to place on your hats, then think, how did the Prophet place on his hats? The companions, you see, when the Prophet would walk in the streets of Medina, he would walk in a variant fashion. The companions say, we would also walk in the variant fashion, just like Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In fact, up to the extent that a companion says, we were at a house in a gathering, and every companion, it was time to cut a melon. We were all cutting a melon. This companion, he paused. He said, I'm not going to cut this melon. He said, why are you not going to cut this melon? It's a gathering. Let's distribute it. The companion says, because I am not aware that how the Prophet cut a melon. I am not aware how the Prophet cut a melon. Because I am not aware of this, even this sunnah, I would like to follow of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I believe. Sayyid Shaykh Hisham, Kabbani, is here, right? Very soon, inshallah, that our eyes are all waiting to see. Our eyes are all waiting to see, inshallah, very soon. SubhanAllah, inshallah, very soon. He says, SubhanAllah, coming back. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, man, that is the message to you, that never turn your lives away from Rasulullah. Always keep your lives, make your destination Medina. Make your destination the streets of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Fill your heart with the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Fill your heart with the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And have full yaqeen and iman on the noor of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. On the noor of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. My dear brothers, come towards one last hadith of regarding the nur of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, just to wake your emotions up, and then inshallah ta'ala we'll come towards the end. Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she says, I'm now speaking again regarding the birth and the nur of Rasulullah. Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she says, one day I was in the house of Rasulullah sewing the kameez, sewing the shawl of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She says, I was sewing the shawl, and as I was sewing it, the chadar he used to wear, I was sewing and I lost the needle. And as I lost the needle, time passed. I lost that needle and I was looking for it. I looked for it under the quilt, under the bed, under the mattress. Everywhere you could possibly look for a needle, I looked for that needle. She says, I failed to find it. Just moments after the Prophet arrived in my house, in his house. And the moment the Prophet arrived, Sayyidah Aisha says, he smiled. He says, the moment he smiled, there was so much nur from the smiling face of Rasulullah. So much nur from the smiling face of Rasulullah. Sayyidah Aisha says, I swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that needle that almost depressed me, I looked under the bed, under the coat, everywhere possible to find that needle. The moment the Prophet came into the house and he smiled, the moment he smiled, she says, I swear by Allah, I found that missing needle for the sake of the nur of Rasulullah. And then let's go further. Again, it's the same Sayyidah Aisha. And she's now trying to dry the clothes of Rasulullah. SubhanAllah. How lucky were those who spent time at the same time of Rasulullah. She says, I washed the clothes of Rasulullah and I was trying to dry it. And what did she say? The way I tried to dry the clothes, the sheet of Rasulullah, she says, I washed it and then I put it over the stove to try and dry it. Once it was warm, so through the heat it could be dry. She says, I was holding it time and time and time. But that chadar was not drying. That sheet was not coming towards it. That sheet was not drying. I was waiting to see, why is it not drying? Looking at it, trying my best to keep it dry. It was not drying. Again, the Prophet, he came into the house. He says, I'll say to Aisha, you're looking very depressed, very worried, very frustrated. What is the reason? She says, oh Rasulullah, I washed your dress. I washed your dress, but now I'm trying to dry it. But I'm drying it. The way I'm trying to dry it is I'm drying it on top of fire. I'm trying on top of fire. I'm using the stove to try and dry it. But your dress is not drying for some reason, oh Rasulullah. The Prophet says, oh Aisha, do you not know? It's the dress of Rasulullah. And on the dress of Rasulullah, the heat of a fire can never have hararat, can never have an effect on the dress of Rasulullah. Because it's the dress of Rasulullah. You may put it as much as close as you want to the fire, but it has no power, no strength to have any connection in terms of heat on the dress of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Just like the dress of Rasulullah was protected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the same way the zikr of Rasulullah is been protected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those who try and degrade the zikr of Rasulullah, or try and degrade through cards and various other means, try and degrade Rasulullah, my dear brothers, whenever we try and even think of doing this act, we are not, what are we doing in fact by doing this act itself of even thinking to degrade the zikr of Rasulullah, you know what this act is? This act itself is a war with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made an announcement, وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ, that I have raised the zikr of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I have raised the remembrance of Rasulullah. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, we have raised the zikr, the remembrance of Rasulullah, for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now the answer, the question comes to mind, and the solution and the conclusion comes to mind, that because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has raised the zikr for Rasulullah, anyone who comes to degrade the zikr of Rasulullah, degrade the remembrance of Rasulullah, in fact and in reality, what is he doing? He's in war with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's placing a challenge with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And surely no one can challenge Allah, and no one can overpower Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why since this universe was created, the Prophet's zikr was remained. Since this universe will remain, the zikr of the Prophet will remain. And even when this universe comes to an end, the zikr of the Prophet, the remembrance of the Prophet will never come to an end. This is our iman.